So you wake up in the morning, rub your eyes, kill the alarm clock, wander down the hall, maybe step up on a bathroom scale. Why do we do that? Why do we do that? What we're trying to do is take a measurement, right? We want to measure our weight. And we want to measure our weight because we equate that somehow to our size and our shape. Viewing that measurement from a nuclear particle physics standpoint, what are we trying to do? We're trying to measure the number of atoms that we're made of, because the number of atoms we're made of, our composition, the number and type, determines our size and shape. And so what would we get if we were the nuclear particle physicist who stepped up on that scale? We'd get about 7 billion atoms, because atoms are really small. So to put that in perspective for you, there's about 7 billion people on our planet right now. So we need 3 Earth-type planets filled with people to equate to the number of atoms that any one of us is composed of. And yet, nonetheless, we're mostly empty. What does an atom look like, this thing? Well, if this auditorium, this theater, was an atom, there would be electrons, little tiny particles I'm not going to talk about, winging around the outside. We don't care about them, because all of the mass, all that which generates weight, all the mass is sitting in a dust speck in the center of the room that we call the nucleus. But that's not the whole picture. Inside the nucleus are protons and neutrons, and inside of those are little tiny things called quarks. And it used to be that these fundamental building blocks of matter, these little quarks, are all there was. At some point, in the very first sub-nanosecond of the beginning of the birth of the universe, there was a volume about the size of a golf ball that everything, you, me, our theater, our city, our state, the United States of America, the world, the planets, the galaxies, all of it was a little golf ball-sized volume of quarks. And this was too much energy to stay contained like that, so it cooled and expanded and cooled and expanded and cooled and expanded and became all of everything. Those quarks became protons and neutrons. Those protons and neutrons became nuclei, and it expanded out to us sitting on our bathroom scale trying to weigh our mass. And so we know how many quarks we're made of. But it doesn't equate to our weight, as it turns out. Those fundamental building blocks that build us up account for about 2 or 3% of our mass. That's it. So where is the mass? Where is the mass of the universe? What's going on? It turns out Einstein gave us a major clue. He told us E equals mc squared. That E is energy, that M is mass. So instead of looking for stuff-type mass, we can look for energy-type mass. And it turns out that in that first little nanosecond when the quarks were forming into protons and neutrons, they got stuck in there. We can never, ever again get out a free quark, as far as we know. They got stuck in there by a really strong force. In fact, it's so strong that us nuclear physicists call it the strong force. We're creative people, right? So they're bound in there by this strong force, and that force in every given proton, neutron that composes the atoms that compose those 7 billion atoms in you, every one of those has a force equivalent to about a car crash level. It's huge, right? And so that generates the energy that generates the mass of everything. Or so we think. Right? These are observations. We can measure, we take measurements and we observe and we puzzle and we try to understand. But we don't really understand this force. We gave it a name and we have this feeling about how the quarks are bound, and we've never found free quarks. We try. We've looked at the way that quarks compose different objects that we can observe. And this is about what we know, and we are continuing to study to try to understand that power that's sitting inside of there. So this is what we do where I work. This is the Thomas Jefferson National Accelerator Facility. And it's a laboratory where a lot of the action is underground. So below those linear parts that you can see on the screen, there are tunnels which contain miles and miles of particle accelerator. Why do we do that? We do that because we want to see into the nucleus. So let's see if I can make that make sense for you guys. How do you see anything, right? You're looking at me, and we're all looking at this beautiful big red dot, right? So how are we seeing this dot? We're using particles, we're using photons, the particles of light. And those are coming down from these really bright lights up here. These photons are coming down and they're bouncing off this red dot and they're bouncing into your eyeballs, into my eyeballs. And our eyeballs are really sensitive photon detectors. And they detect these photons and send signals to our brain about the photons. So we translate the wavelength of those photons as the color. And we translate the number of photons as the intensity or the brightness. And then we have a mobile unit that we can wander around and look at different intensity and brightness and color from different angles, called our body, right? And we can do all of that. So that's how we see anything, right? You're not interacting with this red dot. You're interacting with the photons. But you're learning about this red dot, right? So how are we going to now see a nucleus? Our red dot is now a nucleus. We can no longer use visible light photons. So what we use are high energy electrons, which explains that miles and miles of accelerator structure at Jefferson Laboratory. We're going to send these high energy electrons into a nucleus and let them bounce out into giant eyeballs into nature. So that's what's in the inset there. You can see there's sort of three there. So you can see there's sort of three circular structures. Those are underground detectors, which are the giant eyeballs into nature. And so the inset is just one of them to give you a feeling for how large these detector systems are comparable to a person. So we build these detectors, and these detectors, just like our eyeballs, tell us information about the particles that are bouncing out of the nucleus or created in that interaction with the nucleus. And eventually that information goes to a computer, which goes to a human brain, and we puzzle and we try to understand it. And that's what we do. So nuclear science at the forefront, trying to answer questions like, what is mass? What is the force that binds us all together? So now, let me pause a minute, because I've told you a lot of things. I've told you you're mostly empty, and I've told you you have a billion, billion, billion car crashes happening in little tiny particles somewhere inside of you, and that scientists build building-sized giant eyeballs into nature, right? And so some half of you are going, awesome, right? You are my peeps, and I love you, right? But the other half of you are going, you know? That's maybe interesting, but I don't see how that practically helps me, and it seems like, I don't know, long hair, ivory tower kind of stuff. Why should I care? Why should we do this? So my big idea for you is none of the things I just said about billions and billions of atoms. My big idea for you is that it is important to support fundamental scientific research. And so I'm speaking to that latter half of you in part, because the other half of you probably already bought in. So, so it is critically important. Why? So I'm going to defend that in two ways. The first way is just historical. If we look back decades to what people were doing 10, 50, 100 years ago to understand the structure of matter and the interactions of those little building blocks of matter, what they were doing, we use today. We sit at a computer, which is a fully solid-state device. The transistors that guide that would not be possible without solid-state physics having been developed. We use lasers, right? We use intense beams of light. That's a laser. We have a power grid all over the world, right? All of these things come from basic human curiosity, people asking questions, what is that, right? And so we don't know what's going to come from this basic human curiosity, the science that we're doing now. We don't know. We're investing in our grandchildren and our great-grandchildren and human curiosity moving forward so we don't stagnate. So that's one reason. But the other reason is maybe even more practical, and it's the other side of what I do. To build these giant eyeballs, we have to develop new technology in real time. Right, we have an experiment to do, and we're going to have to see some interaction or some particle that no one's ever seen before, and we're going to have to figure out how to do that. So we're developing things all the time. And so sometimes that development takes a long time to make its way out into the rest of the world, out of the ivory tower and down, or up, or whatever. But sometimes we can facilitate that. And so I try to do that. I try to work on, in particular, facilitating technology moving from nuclear and particle physics into medical instrumentation. So I'm going to give you just one example of that. Okay? So I'm going to talk to you about proton radiotherapy as one example. So proton radiotherapy, so you heard about protons, we're made of them, quarks make them somehow, that's all you really need to know. What I want to talk about for the radiotherapy is this. Radiation therapy is used to kill cancer. When we say radiation therapy is used to kill cancer, we're talking about x-rays. So x-rays do what we all know that they do. We use it all the time. We've maybe been for a dental x-ray. You can send a beam of x-rays in here and put a detector over here. And x-rays, we understand, they're particles of light. They're very high energy particles of light. So we give them a special name. We call them an x-ray, but it's a photon. It's a particle of light. So it's going to come in and it's going to go out. And some of those photons will be absorbed by dense material like bone, and some will be less absorbed by less dense material like muscle. And so the bone will cast a shadow on an image, and I can take an x-ray and look at my teeth. Okay? Very, very practical, very useful. But if what I want to do now, I want to kill something part of the way in that person, right? I want to kill a tumor that's in there. Now, this fundamental physical property of x-rays that they're going to travel all the way through and out the other side becomes a problem because I need to deliver a killing dose. And so that killing dose is going to go all the way through and out the other side, which means that, yes, I may do in the tumor, but I involve other tissue. So now what we have to do is we have to deliver a low dose here and a low dose here, right, and a low dose here and a low dose here, so that that crossing point, that star crossing point, is the tumor has a very high dose and the rest of the tissue has a low, hopefully tolerable dose. But what if you understood how other kinds of particles traverse matter, protons in particular? Protons traverse matter very differently. Protons are charged. Protons are made of quarks, right? Protons interact differently in matter. And so by tuning the energy, we can actually cause them to lose all of their energy in a programmed place. And because we can control the beam energy by building and understanding accelerator technology, we can control where they lose the energy, and so right in the tumor and not everywhere else around the person. So it's an improved tumor killing beam generated by fundamental nuclear physics. So that's one example where nuclear physics can make a difference in our daily lives, right? We've gone from this universe where all the quarks are in a golf ball to actually utilizing how particles traverse matter to make a difference in cancer care. And so I will share with you one last thing to answer the question or at least address our TEDx big idea we're sharing, that it is very important to continue curiosity-driven fundamental science to support that. I'll share a personal story. The other week or so ago, I was sitting in a control room in a proton radiation therapy center, one that I got to work on the development of, and I was sitting there in a control room, actually, that I helped design, staring at equipment that I specified and picked out and chose and helped to install and commission. And I was watching a patient move through the equipment, and this is a brain tumor patient, a deadly brain tumor. Brain tumors are particularly important for proton therapy because, as you can imagine, all of that healthy tissue sparing is brain tissue. And we all care about our brains, what goes on in there. And so very, very important. And so moving this patient through, I was staring at something I'd stared many times before, only this time that patient was my own beloved husband of many years. So I will leave you with our big idea as a question. Is continued investment and support of curiosity-driven fundamental science important? Absolutely.